Studios here in Dublin, Georgia. It's Cowboys Artist Spotlight, brought to you by Mike's Music and Entertainment, and I'm your host, Cowboy Mike Ward. Welcome to our show. This is our first ever podcast. We want to welcome you for joining us. Thank you for joining us, and welcome you to the show. You can go to patreon.com/Mike's Music and Entertainment to sign up to be a subscriber or a sponsor to the show. If you'd like to be a subscriber, it's $5.99 a month. Not a show, but a month. If you'd like to be a subscriber, it's $50 a month. That gets you discounts on merchandise and also services that Mike's Music and Entertainment offers. Now, this is basically the intro to our podcast. What we do is, we will spotlight different artists of all music genres. You know, at first we talked about just doing country and gospel, but now we're going to expand that just across the globe. We're going to do country, we're going to do gospel, we're going to do rock, we're going to do some rap. I'm not a big rap guy, but we will do rap because if that's what you want to hear, that's what we'll do. Because this is a podcast for you listeners. Now, we can't make this podcast possible without you. So again, if we need subscribers, we need sponsors. You can go to patreon.com/Mike's Music and Entertainment, sign up to be a subscriber or a sponsor. We would greatly appreciate that. I'm not doing this for the money. I'm doing this because it's something fun that I found that I really want to do. We're going to be, like I said, we're going to be spotlighting different artists across all genres. We're going to do some cover songs of those artists. We're going to have some trivia. Once we get some audience participation in, we're going to be doing some questions and answers. We've also got jokes and funny stories. It's going to be a blast. I really hope it gets off the ground. I've got high hopes for it. So again, basically, this is our maiden voyage. We want to welcome you on a maiden voyage. This is our very first ever podcast. We've had some test runs that I've posted before, but this is it. This is the big tamale. This is the show. Thank you for joining us again. So let's get into it. You know, Mike's Music and Entertainment has been around for a while. May not know that, but I believe about 20 years ago, I really started getting into karaoke, you know, hosting karaoke shows and stuff like that. I've been singing my whole life. There's pictures of me 2-3 years old with a microphone in my hand singing the music. So I've really liked singing my entire life. I've liked music, and I really didn't tie down to any specific genre. I liked country. I liked rock. in the 80s, I liked some of the rap that was coming out. Back then, rap was actually listenable. Some of today's music is just a lot of vulgarities, and it's really hard to listen to. But back in the 80s and 90s, you know, rap was really entertaining to listen to. There were groups that I believe carried their music a little too far, but excuse me, Two Live Crew. They were a rap group, very vulgar and explicit lyrics in their music, but they did have advisories on the CD cases. There was instances where they were actually getting arrested, even though they were performing for adult audiences. That sparked the song Banned in the USA by Two Live Crew, which is a pretty decent song. I don't believe there's any language in that song, so you can actually go to that. I'll tell you, you can go to that and listen to. Pretty decent song. It's along the guidelines of Born in the USA by Bruce Springsteen. But it's called Banned in the USA. It's pretty good song about how censorship was starting to really take hold of the music industry. And we see in today's world that censorship is everywhere, especially on Facebook. But we're not a political podcast. We're not going to deal with any kind of politics whatsoever. There's enough of that out in the world today to have to deal with. This is solely going to be music-based. All of our jokes and stories, all that is going to be strictly to music. So, and we hope you enjoy that, and we will graciously accept any kind of criticism you have, whether it's good or bad. It really doesn't matter. If there's something you'd like for us to do or you know, maybe spotlight on here, you know, let us know. We have three ways you can contact us. Of course, we have patreon.com/Mike's Music and Entertainment. You can go there and leave us a message. You can look us up on Facebook, Mike's Music and Entertainment. We also have a website called Mike's Music and Entertainment at uniweb.com. That's spelled UNIWEB.com. Mike's Music.uniweb.com. You can leave us a message on any three of those platforms. We try to get back to you as soon as possible, but I do have a full-time job. That keeps me busy mostly during the days. But I do my best to try to get back to any questions you have and concerns and comments. We want you to comment. We want you to send us messages. We really want to have an audience that we can interact with. Like I said, once we get that audience going, we'll have some Q&A sessions. I'm working on how I want to do that. You know, I may just, you know, Facebook Live somebody. Not Facebook Live. FaceTime somebody. And, you know, just have the audio. We won't put your video on. We're solely an audio podcast. I played with the idea about doing video, but I have a face for radio, so we're not going to do videos. So I really hope this gets off the ground. We're asking for subscribers, of course, and sponsors to help fund some of the expenses that goes along with running a podcast, you know, but I don't mind doing this for free. I don't mind paying out of pocket some of the expenses that we will incur to run the podcast. But, you know, I will be posting this one on a social media platform free of charge. You won't have to pay to listen to this one. So you get an idea of what you're going to get. Again, it's $5.99 a month for subscribers. That's not a podcast. That's a month. You can cancel at any time. If you sign up, you don't like it, say, this guy sucks, you can cancel. No hard feelings. We appreciate you giving us a try anyways. And we're also looking for sponsors. Now, sponsorship is $50 a month. If you have a small business, big business, a side gig on Facebook, if you're having yard sales and you want to get that information out, we will do some kind of discounted pricing for one-time, advertising. But again, $50 a month gets you sponsorship. It doesn't matter how big your business is, how small your business is. If you're selling jewelry on Facebook, we'll get your business out there to the hopefully listening public, and that also gets you discounts to we're having merchandise made up. We have a merchandising department with Patreon. We've partnered with Patreon. They're going to do all of our merchandising for us, and it also gets you discounts to services by Mike's Music and Entertainment. We do, you know, we do DJ, we do karaoke shows. We MC any event, really. We've done a whole bunch of pageants, and we've done some fundraisers. And we also do sound. If you want us to come just set up a sound system for somebody else to MC or DJing or something like that, we can do that too. No venue's too small. We can handle larger venues. So basically, you know, $50. And that's also for the subscribers as well. You also get that discount. We also, what else is on my list? You know, we're going to do trivia. We're going to have different trivia questions, and we're going to do some jokes and funny stories throughout the podcast. And, you know, basically that's the podcast. You know, hopefully it gets off the ground. We get going pretty good. And, again, we need sponsors. We need subscribers to help make this happen a little easier. I'm going to do it regardless, even if I got to come out of pockets, no big deal. If you go to Facebook and look us up, Mike's Music and Entertainment, we also have a link on there. We actually have a GoFundMe page set up to where you can make a one-time donation if you'd like to help support us. That would be great as well. And let's see, what else did we have going here? Looking at my notes, I made notes, but I get scattered brain when I'm trying to go in different directions. So again, you know, the podcast, we're spotlighting music artists of all different genres, and normally we would pick one artist, but with the maiden voyage of our podcast today, we don't have a specific artist that we're going to do. So, you know, we're basically just going to cover, you know, different artists and stuff like that with our trivia questions and our jokes and stories and stuff like that. And with the cover songs, you know, when we spotlight a specific artist, we're going to pick some of their songs and I'll do cover songs for them since I love to sing. And but today, you know, since we didn't have a specific spotlight, I just picked three random songs that I want to sing. The first song is a song called Brotherly Love. Now, this song was actually written by Jimmy Allen Stewart and Tim Nichols, which was recorded by Mo Banley originally, as well as the duet between Keith Whitley and Earl Thomas Conley. Banley's version appeared on his 1989 studio album Many Mansions for Curb Records. The song was the second single from that album, reaching a peak at number 53 on the country music charts in 1989. Keith Whitley and Earl Thomas Conley also recorded the song as a duet in 1987, but it wasn't recorded on an album until it concurrently appeared on Whitley's posthumous 91 album Kentucky Bluebird and Conley's 1991 album Yours Truly. The duet version charted for 20 weeks on Hot Country Singles and Tracks, peaking at number 2 and holding that position for 1 week. In 1992, this version was nominated for Country Music Association for Vocal Event of the Year. It also earned them the nomination for a Grammy Award for Best Country Collaboration with Vocals. And that is the song Brotherly Love, which is a song I will cover for you now. So give me just a moment, and we'll sing to you Brotherly Love, Earl Thomas Conley and Keith Whitley.
Take long until push comes to shove. We looked out for each other with brotherly love. You hated girls to lie at my first date. I brought her home from the movies. You stayed up. On the couch watching TV, I was smiling at her while you were laughing at me. But I wouldn't trade it for nothing, brotherly love. There's a bond that brothers know, and it gets stronger as it grows.
That's one of my favorite songs to sing. I always try to sing it whenever I go out to sing. It's just a great, beautiful song. Keith Whitley, of course, a magnificent artist, left us way too soon. So let's go into some trivia, shall we? Now, we're going to do trivia, and hopefully it gets to the point where we can have a trivia contest. You know, once we get, you know, folks that want to sign up and be a part of that, and we can do a trivia contest where we take one winner of every week. We're going to try to do at least one podcast a week is the basic goal of what we're going to do. Excuse me. So we're going to take each winner for that week, put them in a drawing at the end of the month, and have a grand prize winner. Now, of course, you know, without any, you know, sponsors or subscribers, we can't really do a grand big prize. But once we get those sponsorships and subscribers rolling in, the prizes will gradually get bigger and bigger. To start out with, maybe, you know, a $25 gift card or something like that. Still working on that. Of course, that all depends on subscribers and sponsors. Gotta have it coming in before it can go out. So hopefully we can get the trivia contest going. I think it would be a lot of fun, get some interaction. Still trying to figure out how to do that, you know, maybe get two or three different people to, you know, FaceTime, call in or whatever, and have a contest that way. I believe three contestants would probably be good, have a winner, and, you know, do something for second and third place as well. But that's all still in the works. We'll get that actually ironed out once we get some subscribers and a audience base in. Let's do some trivia here real quick. Now, this first question is going to be an easy one. If you don't know this, I don't know what rock you're living under. The question is, which country star sang the theme song to the hit TV show Dukes of Hazzard? Now, I will give you multiple choice. We have Waylon Jennings, Willie Nelson, Kenny Rogers, or George Strait. If you picked anybody other than Waylon Jennings, you got it wrong, because Waylon Jennings, not only wrote and sang the theme song Good Old Boys, but also provided narration for the show and even played himself in an episode. Let's see. Let's do another one here. Let's see. Willie Nelson wrote On the Road Again on what? You have his forearm, toilet paper, a hamburger wrapper, munchies, or a barf bag. So, what do you think it is? I actually got it right on the first one. It was a barf bag. During a flight to Hollywood, the producers of the movie Honeysuckle Rose approached Willie about writing a song for the movie, in which he played a country singer juggling his music career with his responsibilities to his wife and son. About 45 minutes later, Nelson had finished the lyrics on one of the airline's barf bags. Pretty interesting. I figured it would have been a hamburger wrapper. Yeah, but, you know, that's all recreational. But anyways, next question. Excuse me, I need to turn those off. Who originally recorded Garth Brooks' 1991 hit, The Thunder Rolls? Now, this one actually really, caught me off guard, because I would not have expected this whatsoever. I'm sorry about the notifications in the background. I got to figure out how to turn that off when I'm doing these podcasts. But anyways, who originally recorded Garth Brooks' 1991 hit Thunder Rolls? We have Kenny Rogers, Dwight Yoakam, Reba McEntire, or Tanya Tucker. Now, I did not know the answer to this, but it was Tanya Tucker. Thunder Rolls was originally recorded by Tanya Tucker, but she didn't release the song until it appeared on her self-titled 1995 box set. Her version included a fourth verse, which Brooks himself intended to use on his version, but cut at the suggestion of producer Alan Reynolds. So now I'm going to have to go back and listen to her version, because I did not know that she actually recorded that song. Appeared on her 95 box set. So she didn't release until after Garth Brooks made it famous. That's actually pretty interesting. I didn't know that. I consider myself to be a fairly decent Garth Brooks guru, who is actually one of my favorite artists growing up. He came into country music and just kicked the door wide open to not really, you know, get away from the traditional sounding country music, which is what I love. You know, George Strait has kept it the same exact way from start to finish, and he's been going strong since the early 70s. And he stands up there with his guitar. He doesn't run around acting a fool. Not that that hurts anybody else from doing it, but it just didn't work for George. He stands there with his guitar. He'll walk around interacting. That works for him, and he's gone strong forever. But going back to Thunder Rolls, when Garth Brooks actually released Thunder Rolls, I believe it was either CMT or GAC. I can't remember which one it was. I'm pretty sure it was CMT at the time. They actually banned the video, stating that it promoted domestic violence. So it was actually one of the first country music videos to be banned by a country music video station, if I'm not, mistaken. I'm going off memory here. But he went to the executive and said, look, if you don't want to play this song, I'll pull my other songs and we'll go somewhere else. So they pretty much, they eventually played the video. It's a great video. I don't see how it promotes domestic violence, but that's just my opinion. Moving on, let's see. We had, which singer-songwriter reportedly landed a helicopter on Johnny Cash's lawn to hand-deliver a music demo? I can just see that happening now. So it's, you have Kris Kristofferson, Kenny Rogers, Charlie Daniels, or Glenn Campbell. Now, the only one I could see doing this is actually the right answer. Eager to kickstart his career, Kris Kristofferson borrowed a helicopter for one of his odd jobs, landed on Johnny Cash's lawn, and hand-delivered his demo to the Man in Black himself. One of the songs on that demo, Sunday Morning Coming Down, became a massive hit for Cash and won Kristofferson Songwriter of the Year honors at the CMA. So that was Kris Kristofferson hand-delivering that demo to Mr. Johnny Cash himself, another one of country's greatest, greatest artists. Let's do one more. Once again, this is about Garth Brooks. Which movie inspired Garth Brooks' hit, The Dance? Now we have four different answers. We had The Karate Kid. Don't see that. Peggy Sue Got Married. I watched that movie. I kind of remember it. Not really. Crimes of the Heart or Room with a View. I believe it's going to be, yep, Peggy Sue Got Married. Originally, The Dance had a very different set of lyrics. Writer Tony Arata says those were lost in a movie and never recorded. The versions fans know today was inspired by the movie Peggy Sue Got Married. So that is our trivia segment for today. Let's do another cover song real quick. Let's see. The next song I want to sing for you is another song I really love to sing. It's a fun song. It really gets you moving and all. The song is by a group called Shenandoah. The song is If Bubba Can Dance, I Can Too. It's a song that recorded by the country music group Shenandoah. It was written by Shenandoah drummer Mike McGuire and lead singer Marty Rabin, along with veteran Nashville writer Bob McDeal. It was released in February 1994 as the third single from their album Under the Kudzu. It was a number one hit in both the United States and in Canada. So, here is my cover version of the hit song by Shenandoah, If Bubba Can Dance.
Well, I saw him out there.
Little ditty, Bubba Can Dance, I Can Too, by the group Shenandoah. Now let's, what are we going to do next? Let's see. Let's do some jokes real quick. We're going to do some little, you know, just a couple of stupid jokes. Something like, you know, what do calculators and country music have in common? Well, both are produced by Texas Instruments. Womp, womp, womp. Yeah, that was kind of cheesy, wasn't it? Here's the old classic. When you listen to rock backwards, you hear satanic messages. What do you get when you listen to country music backwards? Well, you get your wife back, your life back, and your dog back. Ba-dum-bum. let's see. How many country music singers does it take to change a light bulb? It takes two. One to change the light bulb, and the other to write a song about the old one. Alrighty then. With new self-driving cars becoming mainstream, country music will change, apparently. Soon we'll be hearing songs about how my truck ran off. Yeah. So, yeah, we're just going to skip past the jokes of it. Let's do some more trivia, shall we? Let's see. Where was Shania Twain born? Now, of course, we all know she is not from Georgia, Texas, or Tennessee, but she is from Ontario. Born in Windsor, Ontario, Shania Twain sold over 100 million records, making her the best-selling female artist in country music history. Which Dolly Parton song reached number one on Billboard Hot Country Songs charts not once, but twice? We had the songs 9 to 5, Here You Come Again, Coat of Many Colors, or I Will Always Love You. Now, of course, it will be I Will Always Love You, thanks to the movie Bodyguard with Whitney Houston, who also recorded that song. But I Will Love You was written as a farewell to her former partner and mentor, Porter Wagoner. First reached number one in June 1974, and then in October 1982, with Dolly's re-recording of the soundtrack of the movie version, Best Little Whorehouse in Texas. Well, that's out. This must have come out way before Bodyguard come out, because when Whitney Houston done that, it also made it big for Dolly again. So, let's see. Let's go to, what pseudonym did Hank Williams use to record a number of gospel songs? Was it Luke the Drifter, Mark the Vagabond, John the Gypsy, or Paul the Rover? Now, if you will have listened to the song by George Jones, he actually mentions this in his song, Who's Gonna Fill Their Shoes. It is actually Luke the Drifter. Although the pseudonym was meant to distinguish Williams' gospel recordings from his more popular country music, Williams insisted on performing his Luke the Drifter songs during his regular concerts. There's a song, bringing up the song, Who's Gonna Fill Their Shoes. Luke the Drifter, when he sang I Saw the Light, and that's where that came from. What was Hank Williams' real name? Was it Hector, Hiram, Hudson, or Holden? I do not know this one, so I am going to say maybe it was Hiram. It was. By the time Hank arrived in Montgomery in 1937, he had decided to drop his given name of Hiram in favor of Hank. According to one of his first steel guitarists, Boots Harris, he'd say that there was a fence outside his house and he'd sleep with the window open, and there was an old cat walking up and down the fence yelling, Harm, harm. He said he thought the cat was calling him, so he changed his name to Hank. The truth was, of course, that Hank sounded more like the name of a Western music star than Hiram. So that's pretty cool. That's pretty interesting. Let's see. One more. Who is the only country female solo act to have number one hit in four straight decades? We have Reba McEntire, Patsy Cline, Tammy Wynette, or Loretta Lynn. Being a Reba McEntire fan, I'm going to go with her. And I am correct. Reba had number one hits in the 1980s, 90s, 2000s, and 2010s. She's actually been one of my favorite female artists of all time. Her along with, oh my goodness. There's so many artists out there. It's hard to Sarah Evans is another. I mean, there's just so many female artists out there that are so great and so wonderful. Reba has definitely stood the test of time. Dolly Parton, still, good gracious, out there kicking it strong. That is... let's do one more. Which country star created a fictional rock persona, Chris Gaines, to explore other musical styles? Was it Alan Jackson, Garth Brooks, Kenny Rogers, or George Strait? It was indeed Garth Brooks. When you're filthy, stinking rich, you can afford to play around and create alter identities, even if some people say it flopped. I actually liked the Chris Gaines album. It wasn't meant to be a country album. It was meant to be a alternate ego rock album. And I actually liked some of the songs that was on it. But initially, Brooks planned to feature the Gaines persona in The Lamb, a motion picture which never materialized. In 1999, Brooks released one album as Gaines. The album produced two charting Billboard single hits, including top five hit Lost in You. I actually liked the whole album, Just Me. Not sure if it was just me being a big Garth Brooks fan, or if the music was that really good. Both are true. It didn't turn me away from Garth. You know, it's somebody out there. You know, he did it. He went out on a limb. He did it. He had fun with it. He owned it. He didn't let it control him. You know, he got backlash for it. But you know what? It was all in fun. I understand that. When you're rich like that, you can afford to have fun, even if it costs you money. It doesn't matter. So, that's my take on that one. So, let's see if we can find some more country music jokes here. Country music is like a vacuum. As soon as you turn it off, it stops sucking. Ow! See, that was hurtful. That was hurtful. I'm a country music buff, so that kind of hurt me. Where do country music artists become country music greats? Oh, the obituaries. Yeah. That was, yeah. But anyways, you know, I grew up listening to music that demeaned women, glorified violence, and normalized criminal behavior. I know it definitely influenced the culture around me. Thankfully, I stopped listening to country music and found hip-hop. Wow. These are obviously anti-country... jokes that we have stumbled upon. When my wife suggested getting a white noise machine for the bedroom, I was initially okay with it. Then I realized I hate country music. Dang. Wow. So many people are hating on country music. It's unbelievable. Went to a game with my dad today, and as we were standing up to sing, the veteran in him kicked in, and he began tearing up. I said to him, you know, technically national anthems are just country music, but I'm bummed. So, anyways, let's go on to our story. This is the segment where we like to tell different stories about different artists. And let's see. It should come as no surprise that Mike Judge chose country music for the backdrop to his animated docuseries Tales from the Tour Bus. Any true country fan knows that when it comes to wild living and debauchery, no one can hold a candle to country music legends. Even the rowdiest, least law-abiding rock star looks downright demure next to Johnny Paycheck. From Blazing Pianos to Shotgun Willie, here are five of the wildest country music stories. Number five, Jerry Lee Lewis sets his piano on fire. Alrighty then. The man called the Killer had some truly wild moments on stage and off. For example, he once shot up a dental office with a machine gun and ruined $50,000 worth of dentures. But perhaps the most notorious Jerry Lee Lewis moment happened on stage. Upset with the lineup on a package tour, the hot-headed Lewis set fire to his piano during Great Balls of Fire and played the instrument as it went up in blazes. Although the story followed Lewis throughout his career, no one can recall the exact date or venue where the actual took place. Billy Joe Shaver asks, where do you want it? Not sure if I should even read this. Maybe I should pre-read these next time. When it comes to founders of outlaw country, much credit for shaping this subgenre has gone to legendary performer and songwriter Billy Joe Shaver. Although outlaw country was more about bucking Nashville trends than breaking the law, a few outlaw singers were known to find themselves in legal trouble from time to time. In 2007, Shaver shot Billy Bryant Cocker in the face outside Papa Joe's Saloon outside Waco. Witnesses say Shaver asked Cocker, where do you want it, before shooting him and fleeing in his truck. Shaver said Cocker had threatened him with a knife and he was simply defending himself. When prosecutors asked Shaver why he didn't just leave the bar before the altercation, he responded by saying, I'm from Texas. If I was a chicken crap, I would have left. Alrighty. That was a paraphrase, by the way. The actual quote had a more demeaning word for crap. Johnny Paycheck raises hell. When it comes to country music rap sheets, Johnny Paycheck can't be beat. There was a time he stole Patsy Cline's car. Then there was a time he got on the CB radio on his tour bus and put out a call to truckers for copious amounts of drugs. Wow. Paycheck's most egregious crime was shooting a man over a heated argument in a dive bar. But a lesser-known story that shows Paycheck's wildcat nature and the time he showed up to a Canadian court shirtless and flipped off the court during the Canadian national anthem. Not a smart thing to do there, John, going to another country and flipping them off during their anthem. The unbelievable life and times of Johnny Paycheck are chronicled in the first episode of Tales from the Tour Bus. I'm going to have to check out this series because, you know, this sounds very interesting. George Jones ventilates his tour bus. And I have a very funny story about George Jones. Country legend George Jones earned the nickname No Show Jones because of his often erotic behavior. And a good bit of that behavior took place on the road. The possum once shot holes in the floorboard of his tour bus with a .38 revolver in an attempt to air condition the no-frills bus known as the gas chamber. Unfortunately, the bullet holes only let in toxic fumes. Imagine that. Now, a little funny story about George Jones. My dad used to work at a place in Millersville called Little River Park. It's a little place right off of Lake Sinclair. My dad, along with the owner at that time, you know, he helped build a lot of the docks and stuff out there. And at Little River Park, you can park your RV, buses, and stuff like that. Well, one night, George Jones and Tammy Wynette pulls into Little River and sets up camp. Now, of course, this was during the time where Jones was fond of the drinkage. He often got a little carried away with his drinking, and of course, that helped incite some altercations with Tammy. In one instance, my dad had to go to the bus and tell George and Tammy to quiet it down, or they were going to have to leave. Well, it wasn't long. Several minutes later, my dad had to go back and tell them to leave. So, my dad actually kicked George Jones out of Little River Park, Millersville, in Georgia, way back when. I forget the exact date. He couldn't remember. But it's just a little funny story, and I just thought it was hilarious. I can't believe that he kicked George Jones out, and my dad said, well, some gum wouldn't be quiet and behave. Next, we have a little story about Shotgun Willie Nelson. Almost shootout. Let's see. Willie Nelson knows how to keep the peace. Never was there more clear than one night in Birmingham Coliseum in Birmingham, Alabama. After playing a show, Nelson and his band were caught in the middle of gunfire in a parking garage. The garage is dark and no one can see who is shooting. The cops arrive, and just when the situation is about to go from bad to worse, Willie strolls off his tour bus in cut-off jeans and tennis shoes, packing two Colt 45 revolvers in jean shorts. I can just see old Willie in jean shorts now. I'm surprised he had a hand free to hold two Colt 45 revolvers with his recreational activities. The zen of the redheaded stranger must have eased the tension because Nelson ended the night signing autographs, chalk another one up to the power of Willie. I love Willie Nelson. I disapprove of some of his behaviors, but he's been a great singer in country music for a long, long time. Let's see. I think we have time to do one more cover song. This song, it's going to be another song by Shenandoah. I like Shenandoah's music. My voice is relatively similar to Marty Rabin's, the lead singer of Shenandoah. We have that high voice. But surprisingly enough, I have a hard time hitting high notes. The Moon Over Georgia is a song written by Mark Narmor and recorded by the group Shenandoah. It was released in April of 1991 as the fourth single from their album Extra Mile. The song reached number 9 on Billboard Country Singles and Tracks in July of 1991. So, here is my cover version of the hit song Moon Over Georgia by the country group Shenandoah.
He owns a big estate just south of Savannah and a high-rise hotel downtown Atlanta, and half the state of Georgia to his name. She'd be set for life in his colonial manor. He lay the world at her feet on a silver platter.
That song. I actually just made a video to that song with me singing the cover of it. Just a whole bunch of songs, a whole bunch of pictures, of me and my wife Sonia from the time we started dating up till now. Just a little montage of how much she really has meant to me over these years and how much she will always mean to me. So that's our and that's pretty much our podcast, folks. Like I said, on a normal podcast, you know, this is the first ever podcast, so it's just basically an introduction of the things we're going to do. Hopefully you like the show. If you have any comments or suggestions about the show, we welcome all forms of criticism, whether it be good or bad. You know, you're not going to hurt our feelings if you say, dude, this sucks. You need to do this instead of that. You know, that's fine. That's what we want. That's where the audience interaction is going to come in. We hope, you know, we get an audience base coming in. Again, to be a subscriber or a sponsor, just go to patreon.com/Mike's Music and Entertainment. Sign up to be a subscriber for $5.99 a month. Not a show, but a month. And also a sponsor for $50 a month. Excuse me. Again, that gets you discounts, you know, special discounts for merchandise and services offered by Mike's Music and Entertainment. And you can cancel anytime you're not locked in. You sign up, you listen to a show or two, hopefully give us, you know, a good fighting chance to win your business. And, you know, if you don't like us after a few shows, cancel us. It won't hurt our feelings. We're asking for subscribers and sponsors to help fund the podcast. You know, there are overhead costs to running a podcast. I don't mind paying these out of pocket. You know, I'm going to do this. We're going to do this. You know, this is something I like doing. It's fun. It's entertaining. And hopefully it'll catch on. You know, right now we don't have anything. We're under the basement. We have absolutely nothing. I'm going to post the first few podcasts on social media, you know, for everybody to listen to free of charge. Hopefully that will get some attention and get us some subscribers and sponsors coming in. Once the subscribers and sponsors, you know, come in and we have that funding help, we can start doing, you know, trivia contests and have, you know, prize winners and, you know, actual cash prizes and some other stuff like that. So, but again, that all depends on sponsors and subscribers. Patreon.com/Mike's Music Entertainment. You can also find us on Facebook at Mike's Music and Entertainment. We also have a website, mikesmusicandentertainment.uniweb.com. Uniweb is spelled UENIWEB. We have a website there with all of our information. You can send us messages on either three of those platforms. And we hope you enjoyed the show. You know, I had fun, you know, doing, you know, test podcasts and stuff like that. You know, there were different things, but I think this one actually went off pretty well. For me, not having any kind of format set up beforehand, I basically just freestyled the whole thing, and I had, you know, little this and that, you know, notes wrote down and stuff. But I get scatterbrained. I don't follow my notes. I don't follow my timelines or anything like that. I just go with it. So we hope you enjoyed the show. We'll be posting this one. This is our first ever Maiden Voyage podcast. We hope you liked it. Once we get our normal lineup going where we actually spotlight a specific artist, it'll be longer because we're going to be adding to the show, you know, basic biography backgrounds of the artists, where they come from, what they've done, their attributes, their contributions, their big hits and stuff like that. And we'll also be doing cover songs of the spotlighted artist of the show. Which is fun for me because I love to sing. You know, there are some artists that I just can't sing that we'll probably cover that I'll just probably play a song from and won't even bother trying to sing, which will probably make a lot of people happy. But So I never claimed to be a great singer. It's just, again, something I love to do. Been doing it all my life. You know, I mentioned at the beginning of the podcast, I've got a picture. I can't be 2 or 3 years old, I believe. Maybe a little older. But about 3 or 4 years old, I would say. But I've got a microphone in my hand. I'm singing. My baby sister's right there next with me. She's done a lot of stuff with me. We've made some very humiliating videos that my cousin actually has some home videos of me doing. Some lip syncing. some stuff I'd like to try to forget, but I know it's going to come back and bite me. You know, if I ever got famous, that'd probably be one of the first things. Downloaded by TMZ or something like that. But my sister and I, we had this little show. I believe it was called On the Spot. I was this hip-hop artist. I don't know hip-hop, but, you know, I was a rock artist, something. You know, I would lip-sync to Tone Loc and John Bon Jovi and stuff like that. I had a little graggly voice trying to emulate Tone Loc a little bit there. It was funny. It was fun. You know, we were kids. My goodness, I think I might have been 12, 13 years old. Who knows? I don't remember. I'm going to have to get the videos from my cousin. I actually burned those. Hopefully she doesn't have copies. But but it's just something that I love to do. Been doing it for all my life again, singing. Singing in the car. You know, doing it professionally about 20 years, roughly, I believe, is when we started doing it professionally. As far as, you know, doing, you know, hosting karaoke shows and stuff like that. Back in 2005, I believe it was, I actually did what, and here in Dublin, we had something called Southern Idol. Of course, it was like an off of American Idol, where it was a singing competition. Made it to the finals. You know, there was somebody better than me. Of course, there a whole lot more, you know, folks better than me that I think, anyways, that, you know, I went further than they did. I don't see how, because I thought they sung way better than I do, but the judges seemed to think I was better than them. So, and that was great. I appreciated their comments and stuff like that. You know, a lot of people say I sing good. I appreciate that. I thank you. And if you would like to, you know, book us for karaoke or live show, I can come sing for you on your front porch if you want to. I love to sing. Any chance I get, I like to set up and sing. I've done it at the school for their spring fling and fall festival several times. Did a few carnivals and stuff like that. It's something that I just love to do. Music and singing, I love doing it. I don't mind doing it for free. It would help to have that sponsorship and subscribership in, mainly so we can do the cash prizes for the trivia quizzes and stuff like that. You know, to be able to give back to the audience for giving to us to help support our podcast. But that's it. And I appreciate everybody who, you know, showed up or who tuned in to listen to us. We hope you tune in next week for the next podcast. We've had a poll going for a while now of who we actually want to do on our first podcast. We decided not to actually do one for our first one, basically just do an introduction of the podcast. So for our next podcast, our actual artist spotlight podcast, we have two artists that I really want to do. We have George Strait and Tracy Lawrence. I don't know which one I want to do first. I love both these guys a lot. I love singing their music. They both have very interesting histories. You know, George Strait, King of Country, absolutely has earned that title. Tracy Lawrence, I mean, he's another great artist. We're doing a poll. I posted a poll, but, you know, and nobody's really, I don't know if anybody just hadn't seen it or if they just hadn't bothered to comment on it. But either way, I may just flip a coin. If that poll doesn't produce any numbers, I'll just flip a coin and go from there. We'll do one week and one the next, excuse me, and go from there. So hope you tune in next week to see which artist we spotlight, either George Strait or Tracy Lawrence. You can cast your votes. You can message me on either three of the platforms. Again, that's patreon.com/Mike's Music Entertainment. You can find us on Facebook at Mike's Music Entertainment or Mike's Music and Entertainment.uniweb.com. Uniweb is spelled UENIWEB. You can contact us on either three of those platforms. We're more than happy to get back with you. Send us your vote, comments, sarcasms, anything. If you have a funny joke or a story that's music related, send it to us. We'll read it on the podcast. We'll give you a shout out as well. And that's the podcast. We hope everybody had fun. I had a blast doing it. You know, hopefully we can, get together and do this again and, you know, just have a great old time. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next week.
The very few moments that we have left, we want to talk right down to earth in a language that everybody here can easily understand.
Thank y'all for joining our podcast today, brought to you by Mike's Music Entertainment here at MME Studios in Dublin, Georgia. Thank you for joining the podcast. Have a blessed day and keep rocking.